Hey everyone, it's Dave. Welcome back for another video. Today I want to tell you about a hugely important national security space launch program and how the fight for these launch contracts between Rocket Lab, SpaceX, Blue Origin, ULA, and others will go a long way to ultimately deciding the winners and losers in the new era of space flight. Before we do that though, I hope you'll consider hitting like to help this video get shared with more people, and if you're not yet a subscriber, hope by the end of the video you will consider hitting that subscribe button. Every subscriber really helps out. So, first of all, let's start off with a brief history of the NSSL, or National Security Space Launch Program. The NSSL program is a United States Space Force initiative that aims to ensure access to space for the United States Department of Defense and other government payloads. The program has its roots all the way back to the 1950s, when the US needed the ability to launch military and intelligence satellites during the space race with the Soviet Union. Formally starting in 1994, though, it was originally called the Evolved Expendable Launch Vehicle Program, with the goal to make space launches for the government more affordable and reliable. The Department of Defense and National Reconnaissance Office spent about $15 billion through the program from 2013 to 2017. To put this into context, the current market cap of Rocket Lab sits under $2 billion as of the filming of this video. Through the launch program, the US government spent enough to buy Rocket Lab itself seven times over, and that is even before adjusting for inflation, as it has risen dramatically in recent years. We're talking about massive dollars here, and the companies vying for these projects absolutely know it. In 2019, the program name was changed over to the NSSL, or National Security Space Launch Program, which we are familiar with today, to better reflect the growing potential for reusable launch vehicles. The NSSL has gone through several phases throughout its existence, each phase lasting several years. We are currently in phase two, which was won back in 2020 by the United Launch Alliance and SpaceX, with ULA being awarded 60% of the launches and SpaceX 40% of the multi-billion dollar contract. Throughout its history, NSSL has been dominated by a small number of very large, old-school space contractors, resulting in perceived, at least, inefficiencies and accusations that the spending on these launches is much higher than should be required on a commercial market. Phase 3 aims to upend this whole paradigm, though, paving the way for a lot of new entrants into the launch contract.
This landmark contract award begins the dawn of a new era in U.S. launch innovation. It promotes competition, maintains the healthiest launch industrial base on the planet, and reinforces global competitive advantage for the U.S. and our allies.
Recently, Space Command has released drafts of their plan for the next phase, giving us detail on how this huge number of valuable launch contracts will be divided up. The industry interest has been enormous, with more than 20 companies attending Industry Day to learn about the new process as well as provide feedback. Lobbying has also been off the charts as these companies try to secure the next decade of this cash cow contract any way they can, influencing the structure of the procurement process to tilt the contracts in their direction. Already in the previous phase of NSSL, SpaceX had to fight their way into the program by suing the government for using uncompetitive practices. Despite all this, ULA still remains extremely reliant on these contracts for the future of their next-gen rocket. In fact, they have received nearly $1 billion from the government to build out the next-gen Vulcan rocket. It also appears likely that Blue Origin has used their legal connections and influence to push their way into Lane 2, despite the plan originally only being for two companies to secure Lane 2, those companies being United Launch Alliance and SpaceX. And despite the fact that Blue Origin does not have a launch vehicle ready, some issues with the location of their launch infrastructure, and more. Phase 3 of this NSSL contract will be divided up into two lanes. Lane 2 will be quite similar to how the NSSL has done things in the past, being restricted to a few companies, whereas Lane 2, where all the interesting action will be happening, and it will be opened up to a lot of new entrants in the space and a much more competitive procurement approach. Lane 2 requires each qualifying company to be able to reach extremely demanding orbital locations with heavy payloads on their rockets, even if individual missions within that lane may not require the performance to reach those locations. This is done to ensure that the market continues to have rockets which can meet the requirements of the NSSL for when these more challenging missions do come around. Lane 2 will have three providers. SpaceX and ULA will be providing the bulk of the launches once again, while Blue Origin will be a new entrant with 7 launches going to their new Glenn rocket. For us today though, in most of the commercial launch space, the focus will be squarely on that lane 1. This is where everything finally changes for NSSL and we're moving away from that old school approach to procurement. Bidders will not be required to meet all of those difficult reference orbits, and as long as their rocket is operational and of a certain size, they should be able to get into the program. This will open the way for Rocket Lab's Neutron, Relativity's Terran R, Firefly's medium launch vehicle, and more to hop aboard and finally participate in these NSSL contracts. It's important to note though, the winners of Lane 2, aka SpaceX, ULA, and Blue Origin, are still free to bid their launchers on Lane 1 projects. This means that up-and-coming players will need to be competitive with the big dogs in order to secure these valuable launch contracts. Lane 1 solicitation will be reopened annually to onboard new providers into the program as their rockets come online. As many as 30 missions will be awarded through this lane on an annual basis over a 10-year period from 2025 through 2034. Proposals for the project are due on December 15th of this year, and contract awards are projected to start mid to late 2024. Several new players in the space have already mentioned they're extremely focused on getting their slice of this pie for phase one, with Rocket Lab and Firefly's management already stating publicly on numerous occasions that they are targeting NSSL and making sure that their rocket is eligible for the program. Even going so far as to make design decisions around their rocket to ensure they are eligible. Relativity is sure to join the fight as well with their Terran R rocket once it gets closer to being ready in 2026 or 2027. Government officials have also preached the need for spreading out these launch contracts between multiple providers in order to avoid monopolies growing in the industry and foster a competitive space launch industry that drives down the costs and allows for new entries. This means that it is extremely likely we will see launch contracts doled out to Neutron, Firefly's MLV, Blue Origin, as well as the traditional companies you would expect to see like SpaceX and United Launch Alliance. It does seem like this current iteration is a bit better for the smaller up-and-coming rocket companies though, with Rocket Lab CEO Peter Beck saying in a recent interview that the company played an active role in helping to shape the government's approach to buying launch services and that they are very happy with the outcome of the Space Force's plan. The question of how many launches each of these companies can secure will come down to getting their rockets ready on time, getting the cost down to a reasonable level where they can compete with other entrants, including SpaceX's Falcon 9, and being able to launch these payloads dependably and on time. Whichever new player in the medium lift space manages to secure the most of these launches will definitely have a leg up on the competition in terms of scaling their rocket's launch cadence and infrastructure, growing into the future, and becoming a vendor of choice for the lucrative government launch industry. Players who either fail to secure these launches or miss out due to launch failures and delays are likely to encounter even more troubles in the future and have even more difficulty competing in the industry. So as the bids are getting ready to be submitted and we expect to start hearing some preliminary results in late 2024, a massive fight is shaping up between all these different prospective launch companies as they try to get their rockets ready on time and secure some of these amazing contracts. I think a lot of it might actually come down to getting ready, as the government is going to be pretty open with allowing entrants into this lane. However, just getting in the lane doesn't mean you automatically get any number of contracts. Once you're inside the lane, you still need to bid on individual contracts and be competitive against all those other entrants in the space. Personally, I do think Neutron will do very well within this lane. I know they've been making a lot of decisions based around making sure they can qualify and get some of these NSSL launches. They have been designed basically from the beginning to compete with Falcon 9. So if SpaceX does bid Falcon 9 on some of these Lane 1 launches, I do think for some of the smaller payloads, Neutron would make a lot more sense. Neutron also seems to be further ahead than Relativity's Terran R or Firefly's medium launch vehicle, something that should surely serve them well as the program starts to get going in the very near future. 2025 is not that far from now when these launches are going to start to take off. So when I think about the future of the Neutron rocket and future customers, one of the two major anchor customers that I'm really hoping Neutron will have going forward is this NSSL Lane 1. I do hope they secure a lot of launches from it. And the second anchor customer, I'm really hoping that Neutron can secure some launches from, and there have been some hints about this perhaps happening in the future, is Amazon's Kuiper constellation. So between those two, if Rocket Lab can secure launches from both of these massive programs, Neutron should be well set up to grow its cadence into the future and become a big player in the medium launch space. When it comes to other up-and-coming larger rockets such as New Glenn, theoretically, if the payload is small enough to fit on a Neutron, I would think that it should be able to come in cheaper than a New Glenn, which is a much, much larger rocket. So I don't even see it really as a competition between New Glenn and Neutron, because, you know, whichever rocket the size of the payload is best suited for is where it would go for. Any vehicles that can fit on a Neutron would go that way. Anything that would require a New Glenn or even a Starship could potentially go that way. And speaking of Starship, it is quite a while card, and the government has said that they are open to having super heavy launchers in that Lane 1, so it remains to be seen how much SpaceX will bid Starship for the future. They do have a lot of their capacity scheduled to launching Starlink satellites, as well as many plans for the moon and even Mars beyond. So I will be curious to see how many launches they do have in their capacity and how many bids they will make on the Lane 1 side, especially if these payloads are a little bit smaller and they're having to compete with much smaller rockets for the same payload. Starship, as always, remains a little bit of a wild card when it comes to the future of the launch industry, at least in my opinion. So with all that in mind, I do think the opening is very much there for Neutron to swoop in and get some extremely important, extremely valuable launch contracts from the NSSL, and I do expect the government to spread out some launches to other providers as well, as they do want to foster that competitive space industry and not end up with just a single provider who can then jack up the price to whatever they feel like, basically, after having driven all other competitors out of business. That's definitely not what the government wants to see, and they're structuring their contracts accordingly. I also do think, even longer term, if this Lane 1 is successful in the current version of NSSL, Phase 4, even further down the line, is likely to potentially do away with that old school Lane 2 philosophy entirely, where they do basically give a lot of money to the companies to develop their rockets to ensure that the capability is out there to hit these difficult orbits, to have such difficult requirements to even get into the lanes. I feel like there's a decent chance all that goes away. They move to a very much more commercial style style procurement process, allowing everyone to bid as long as they can handle that specific payload. I think that would be better for the government, save more money for taxpayers, and better for the industry as a whole. So I am hoping beyond that 2034 timeline to see things open up even further if this lane one is a success starting 2025, which I have every reason to think that it will be. But what do you think? How do you think Neutron's chances stack up against some of these other rockets? Will NSSL be a substantial part of Neutron's launch manifest in the first few years of operation? And is this going to be one of Rocket Lab's bigger customers in the future? They definitely did decide to launch out of the United States on Neutron for a reason, as opposed to sticking with New Zealand like they have traditionally on their Electron rocket. Let me know what you think about all these questions in the comments below. And thank you guys so much for watching. I hope you found this video informative. If you did, please give me a like and subscribe. They always help out so much. And I hope you have a great weekend. I'll see you in the next video. Bye for now.